So, good morning everyone. I welcome you to lecture number 5, our course Collective Dynamics of Firms. I would argue that we have not reached the critical mass here, right? So, I mean, it's a bit also up to you. If you have an interest that I teach you, then you may want to show this by your personal attendance, right? If you don't show it by your personal attendance, then what can I do, right? So the only thing I can recommend is maybe you want to watch a video of last year or you want to read the slides yourself or something. Why should I waste my time talking to you, right? I mean, this, of course, is addressed to the wrong people because you are here. But I assume who's from MTech? So, okay, why don't you talk to the other MTech students about this? That would be my recommendation, right? So you sit and say, okay, well, we have two options now. This professor cancels his commitment and then we have to see how we get the credit points, or we team up and just attend the course, right? These are the two options. But if you just leave it like this, then there will be no improvement, of course, right? So what's your comment on this?
I have talked to some
people. Yeah. Yeah.
But like, I don't know, no one showed interest, and this is really surprising because the course is very, very interesting.
Yeah, I don't know why as well.
I cannot explain why people are not interested in this course, and instead they take like regular economics courses.
Okay, yeah. There's nothing against regular economic courses, yeah. But what I do not understand is, so there are 19 people subscribed to this course, right? So that means if I go and look into the number of registered students, so then I would assume I should teach, right?
Maybe you can stop recording the videos and then people will come.
This is a good question. Why do I record the videos? Because my personal feeling is that it largely improves the grades. So basically, this is a service to you. So, I mean, you do not recognize it now, and you in particular not because you are here. But then when you prepare for the exam, right, so then you have no clue what was the message of slide number, pam, 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 right? So, and then the nice thing is you go to these videos, there's a slider that shows you precisely the slide, and then you go there, and then you can listen to my comments. So that's why we do it, because we learned that people, by having this additional possibility to repeat the lecture, do better in the exams. That's the reason for this. Yeah. So. But I mean, I also understand that many other professors from the MTech, but also other professors I meet in ETH, are against this, because that's the effect, right? So I'm not sure how we handle this.
Maybe so you can introduce a system where people can.
Yeah, but you see, yeah, I know though in economics it's all about incentives and the right incentive, okay? I think the only incentive I accept is that's an interesting course, I would like to learn about it, right? I mean, what other incentive should I set? Yeah? Should I pay you for coming here or what? No. Okay, that's, yeah, I have a complete different opinion on this. So I think you are here because you like the course and you're interested in the topic, right? So that's the issue. So let me do it like this. So I define the critical mass of this course as 5 people. Yeah? That's something I will also send out today. So if there are less than 5 attendants, we skip it, right?
So we cancel the course, or you like.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, then it's up to the students to inform me, okay, now we are ready to come to the lecture. So we will still upload the slides because we have prepared all the material. We will upload the literature, the self-study talks, everything. Yeah. But I'm not here available to teach. So Then you can, if you really want to see the course, so then you may want to pick a video from last year. But just as a word of warning, so we improve the course every year. There is no clear relation between the material we hand out this year and the video we have recorded last year. Because every year, even if the student does not assume this, we improve the course. We sit together with the student assistant, with the assistant of the course, which is Pavlin, and improve the slides, right? So that means you may find material that was not covered last year and so on. So then it's all up to you, right? So I will send out this email today, and then you can coordinate, right? If there are no 5 people attending this lecture, no one will stay here and give the presentation, right? No, it's really up to you. Okay. You might still be able to do the exam at the end, of course, yeah. So, but then by means of your own self-study effort. Right? Okay. Let me conclude what we did so far. So today we are finishing our empirical part and we'll start with the modeling from next week on. So that means by today we have learned all the phenomena that we would like to describe in terms of models, and then next week we try to find out what kind of agent-based models do we need to reproduce the Stahlitz fact we have learned about. So we will do this step by step. We start with a very simple model and then we recognize what needs to be added in order to capture it. So you learned about the Stahlitz facts of distribution. There was one related to the size distribution. It's a skewed distribution. Well, we were not specific. You remember why we were not specific? Because different data sets argue for different skew distributions. This is not a mistake, that is reality. Second distribution was about the growth rate, that we were very specific, right? Because all the available data points into the same direction. And I recall that even the growth rates of GDP or of university expenditure on R&D was following these growth rates. That's a remarkable fact. So then we also talked about parameter dependencies. There was Stahlitz fact number 3, which told us that the growth volatility depends on the size. This is not to be mixed up with the growth rate. That's a very important thing. If you have to recapitulate the Stahlitz fact in the exam, then you hopefully note the difference. Today we talk about 2 other Stahlitz facts. The first one is about dependency on age. And the second one is related to entry and exit dynamics of firms. So let me go to the first slide that addresses the age dependency. If someone will close the door, I don't mind. So you have enough imagination to guess that there is an age dependency on the growth rate. This is via the size. Usually firms start with a small size and they grow like in population dynamics. And of course, if you are young as a firm, then you have a smaller size. If you are older, if you have survived, then of course you have a bigger size in some sense, right? So that means we can guess already about this. And what the Stahlitz fact number 4 tells us is that the older the firm is, the smaller the growth rate is. So this is not only a size-dependent effect. You could then, of course, say, okay, how is age correlated with size? And then you map it down to the size, but that's wrong. Why is it wrong? I've written it here. The growth rate does not depend on size, right? But the growth rate depends on age. So we cannot simply substitute it, even if we have a logical argument that there is this dependency, we cannot simply substitute age by size, right? Because the growth rate does not depend on size, but it depends on age. That's the difference. Please, sir.
Age depends on, size depends on age.
In some sense, but you can be a whatever five-man company for 20 years, right? This is just your optimal size, yeah? You are consulting rich clients about how to invest their money, right? So, and five people is just enough to do this. So there is no need for you to grow over time. That's what we say. So, and if you have not grown over time, then this Stallard's fact tells us you will likely not grow in the future, right? Because the older you are, the more likely you have already reached an optimal size and then stays at that. Please.
Can we say that if even we find some dependence of size depending on age, it's something individual for every field, there's no system and there's no statistical meaning?
You could say it like this, that's correct, right, that's correct. Because what we said on the previous slide is that we do not see the mean growth rate depending on the size, right? So, but for individual firms, there might be correlations. You know? But these correlations do not really point into a direction that we can call this a Stallard's fact. You know? You got the point here. I'm not going to discuss this in more detail here. You know? So. Instead, we are looking into something differently, namely how does the distribution of growth rate changes over time. We learned that the distribution of growth rate is a Laplacian distribution. This was confirmed only for the one-year growth rate. I did not mention this explicitly, but that's the underlying assumption. It holds for 1 year. But if you look now into larger time intervals, how will the growth rate distribution change? Will we still find a Laplacian distribution? And we can see it here. So the thick black line is the 1 year growth rate. You see it here, this is number of years. And then you see how the shape of the distribution changes if we go for larger time intervals, like 16 years growth rate is the maximum here. This depends on the data sets that we have available. Right? So. What we notice here is, of course, that the picture becomes a lot more weak. So we cannot clearly identify exponential or double exponential or Laplacian distribution if we go for larger times because it's very broad. Yeah? No one really knows what. If you please recall, a double exponential distribution in this plot has to be a straight line, right? So, like this. You see that this already does not hold for smaller firms. That's something we will, I think we already have discussed last time, because the volatility depends on the size, that's the average here, right? So you have a huge fluctuation here. So, but there is a straight line, at least in the vicinity of the mean. But this here is no longer a straight line, clearly not, right? That's what you see here. You also see these bends here, no? So, okay. The second question was how we found a dependency of the volatility on the size. I hope that everyone is able to write this down in a very simple equation, right? The volatility is proportional to the size to the power of minus b or b, right? So, and then we talked lengthily about the fact that the b is obviously 0.2 for different for different growth processes. Oh, sorry. No, that was the wrong direction. So here we go. So we recall from the previous lecture that in this plot this has to be a straight line where the slope is equal to the beta. So, and here you see that the beta depends on time. Yes? This one is a log-log plot, yes. This one, or what? No, here, sigma proportional to x to the minus beta, right? So that's the straight line here. Are you talking about this picture or that picture? About this picture. Okay. Yes, the double exponential distribution, of course, is a real straight line only if we go for a log normal plot, right? Where this axis is log plot and this is a normal plot. This is not a log-log plot, that's a log-normal plot. But this is a log-log plot. I didn't know what picture you were referring to. That's a log-normal plot, growth rates, yeah? And that's the log-axis.
So an exponential is a straight line on the semi-log.
On the semi-log plot, yes, correct. Yeah, as we discussed last week. All right, so what you see here is the beta depends on time, right? If you go for larger times, then the beta is no longer 0.2, but it decreases a bit, so, which is equivalent also to the picture on this side. So here you see if we do the scaling, we still get a nicely scaled distribution. So that means the scaling relation that we were talking about last week still holds. So you see this here nicely fitting towards the master curve, right? So, okay. Now let us think of the growth volatility not dependent on size, but dependent on time. So this basically is how does the sigma depend across time, right? So this is for five different time periods. And that is addressed here. Here are the five different time periods. Let us first look into the thick black line, because that's the smallest size over time. And you see here, this is clearly not a linear curve. In fact, what it is, it's something like proportional to square root of t, well, approximately. So, whereas for the large firms here, these are the larger size classes, this dependency, how the sigma square develops over time, is a linear relationship, right? So, what does it mean that this linear relationship does not hold for smaller firms? So it means that, in particular, if you look here into this nonlinear part in the beginning, yeah, it points to some anti-correlation, which is very clear. If you are a small firm, yeah, and you grow in 1 year by 50%, yeah, that is not a surprise, because if you have like four people or three people and you hire one more, so then you easily reach this kind of growth rates, right? So 25-50% is not a surprise. So, but because you are a small firm, you can probably not keep this growth rate for the next year and the next year. So you will probably not hire the next, but the upper next year, and so on, right? So that means there is what we see in anti-correlation. If you hire this year as a small firm, the likelihood that you also hire next year is smaller, right? The same for me. So I run a small company, a share, yeah? So I don't run a company, but if I look into my chair, so there are like 15-20 people. And of course, if I hire a postdoc this year or two postdocs this year, the likelihood that I hire two postdocs next year is much smaller, right? So, but then if time passes on, then of course, after 3-4 years, the likelihood that I hire one or two new postdocs is of course increasing. So and that's what it says here for this. But for large firms, we do not see this. We see that sigma square, the volatility of the growth rate, simply almost linearly increases with time. So again, this picture refers to this picture here. And because we understood the time dependence here, we were able to scale this to the master curve, right? So that's somehow the visual proof that we understood how the different variables depend on each other, right? Okay. Now let me come to the second important topic of this lecture. It's about entry and exit dynamics. This is actually one of the most important issues in the dynamics, in the collective dynamics of companies. One issue is about the performance of established companies, but another, even equally important issue is the number of firms constant? Is it decreasing? Is it increasing over time? So entry means new firms enter the market. Exit means firms are dying. So they leave the market. They can die on various reasons. There can be a merger, for example. Company A and Company B merge in order to form a larger company C, right? So then I see in my statistics two firms died and one firm was born, right? Or your big company buys this small company, right? So then I see one company disappears from the market, so and another company had a huge growth rate, right? So I cannot really, if I just look into growth dynamics, I cannot really distinguish these events. Therefore, it makes sense to look into the independent statistics. We are not talking about merger and acquisition data here. That's probably covered in other courses. We just talk about entry and exit, means the number of firms entering the market and exiting the market. So here on this slide, we have defined the entry and the exit rate. These again are ratios. Why do I mention this? Because a rate for me, that depends on my education, of course, a rate is number of events per time interval. Right? But what they call rate here is in fact the ratio. So the percentage of firms that enter the market given that there are already N firms in the market at time T. And the exit rate is defined accordingly. And what we usually then observe is the number of firms at the time t plus 1 and the number of firms at a time t. And this, of course, is a net rate, entry and exit. So in most cases, if we see that the number of changes, that the number of firms changes, then we see the difference is a net rate. From the data, we cannot tell how many firms have entered the market and how many firms have exited. We can only tell that the net rate is either positive or negative. But going to data, census data, for example, we also know precisely these numbers. Yeah? If I see the difference is 1, then it can be 100 minus 99, but it can also be 10 minus 9, right? And we need to know these numbers in order to get a better idea about the dynamics. The net rate by itself has not the full information. Okay, let me first argue a bit with you about the meaning of entry and exit rate. So we also come to this in a few other slides where we talk about Mr. Schumpeter later. So this entry and exit dynamics is also dubbed as turnover. And I think there are other courses, at least for the MTech students, which cover this phenomenon of turnover, right? So did you enter any of these other courses already?
Maybe technology and innovation management.
Okay, so there you already talked about turnover rate. Yeah, okay, good. So that means you have already an idea. So you can see the turnover process as a selection process, right? It's a turn. So if new firms enter the market, then one assumption could be they have a new product, a new technology, which they then propose to the market, which will probably survive. And firms who are already established and not adaptive enough, they have to leave this. So that means turnover is good because the innovation then propagates in the market, and all those firms who are not able to adapt to the innovation are simply kicked out. So this is one argument that is usually used. So people think turnover rate is good. So, but.
So entry and exit is always related, upwards at the same time?
Pardon me?
Okay, the entry and exit.
Yeah.
Okay, new firm implies that all the firms are.
Not always. We will look into this. Okay. Entry and exit are two different processes, actually. There is some correlation, but there's also some anti-correlation. That's the rest of these. Slides is exactly talking about this. So. But here I'm talking about the turnover as a general phenomenon. So usually people think turnover is good, because it puts some pressure, some selection pressure on the market, and badly performing firms or firms who are not adaptive enough are kicked out, and new firms get a new chance, right? So, but we can go a bit further, and that's probably also discussed in this lecture about business dynamics. We can see turnover also as an indicator of a decline in the firm performance. No? There is a saying about the rats that leaves a sinking ship, right? Have you heard about this? That's a German proverb. Yeah? The rats are leaving the sinking ship. So when the rat march out, so then it's very clear that the ship is about to sink, right? So, and that's something you see here as well. So if the turnover in managers increases, then there's a strong correlation to the fact that firms are dying, right? You can even follow this in the NZZ when they then tell you that the famous whatever CEO left the so-and-so company. So then, okay, the general conclusion is there's something wrong. Maybe there are strong tensions, maybe there are other issues, and of course this person will not ruin his or her reputation, right? So they better go early and leave it to the others to manage the closure of the firm, right? All these kind of things. So that means there is a little bit more information involved in this turnover data. What we also have to say is that there is no clear pattern about entry and exit rates. If it really depends on the different industries, so, and it depends on general dynamics, on business cycles, and other things. So. And so sometimes you argue that it is related to profitability. The firm had to leave the market because it was no longer profitable, right? So that can be an argument, but the entry rate is usually covering firms that are never profitable. So that's something I think we put on the next slide here. Yes. So you cannot correlate the entry rate with the profitability. That's what I wanted to say, right? So, because new firms are likely never profitable. So, so there is no clear correlation between entry and profitability, but there is a clear correlation between entry and innovation rate. That is what we're also going to discuss with Mr. Schumpeter's theory afterwards. And here are a few arguments that I gave for this. So we assume that the new firms are the carriers of some innovations, and if you have a large number of new firms entering the market, then you have a high innovation rate. This is not true, as we will see afterwards. There is a positive correlation. There's a positive correlation, but there is not the conclusion that the new firms have to be the source of the innovation. You see, that's an issue of interpretation, right? Although established firms can be the source of innovation, it doesn't exclude this because of this correlation here, right? So that's the important thing. You got it, right? So here's some data from Switzerland. I copied it, I think, from a newspaper. Yes. Pardon me?
It is an indicator of more competence. Okay, maybe it's not a source of innovation, but if a first new entrant in the market, all companies say, okay, we need to innovate.
It could be also in parallel, right? So I want to say established firms can innovate and new firms entering the market can innovate. So if I have a large entry rate, I usually have a large innovation rate because new firms are entering the market, but it doesn't mean that the old firms never do anything. That's the conclusion. So let's look here into this data. It's of interest if you want to launch a startup company. Maybe you are thinking about this. So then you can have an office in Technopark, but as far as I'm told, Technopark is always booked out. So means all the new firms have difficulties to find nice places. Yeah? So here we see that half of all new firms only reach the 5 years limit. Yeah? So it means half of all firms die. And here we see also how they die. Yeah? So after the first year, 80% are still in the market, that means 20% have died, 30% have died in second year, so then 35% in total on the third year, and 40% in the fourth year, and again another 10% or 11% to be precise in the fifth year. So this indicates how difficult it is to establish a firm in the market. There is, of course, a strong dependency according to the different sectors. We see, for example, if you talk about consulting or if you want to run an insurance company or something like this, you are a broker for insurances, so then there is a small entry barrier only. Right? So that means we see lots of companies established this way, but we also see lots of companies that leave this way. So here, if you go for another sector like construction area, yeah, you have to invest a lot initially. So that means the entry barrier is quite high. But this means then once you got the money together to establish your construction company, you are in a better situation. So not 50% of these companies will die. It's a bit lower, right? So the last bullet point here tells us about the importance of the new firms. I mean, usually politicians tend to think in terms of employment or unemployment, which implicitly affects tax income and all these kind of things, right? And here you see if you are able to establish a firm that survives in the market, then usually these firms have strong growth rates. So employment grows grows at 25% after 3 years and at 52% after 5 years. So if you survive, then you have already put 50% more of your initial size in terms of employees, right? Therefore, it's important to have new firms, although in terms of having new jobs. That's the message of the last bullet point. So then, this year, different from last year, we have, So we have some more tables included. So I don't think that we had them last year, but I'm not so sure. This is the usual way econometrics places the results, right? And we have to learn how to deal with this. So, I mean, I'm not particularly fond of looking into big tables, but that's simply part of the research tradition in this area. So we have to look into this. In case you want to know the details, in the notes there is the paper, and you find the paper also when you go to the Moodle platform under literature. So if you want to read precisely about the interpretation of these numbers, please go and look into this. I'm not able to cover all the details of this table here, but I also do not want to avoid this table. We look into a few interesting things here. So what Mr. Dunn did here was comparing entry rate and exit rates here, and he had a data set available that refers to the U.S. manufacturing industries. So this is data from the U.S. manufacturing industries over different time intervals, which is quite useful. Refers to the U.S., different time intervals here. And let us first look into all firms and smallest firms deleted. So you see, though, this is basically a percentage, but the most important thing is the difference. So the smallest firms are defined, I think it's written in the note here, at those who together produce 1% of the number of firms, of the number of the industry's output. So let's assume 10 firms enter the market, right? 9 of these are one-man companies, yeah, and 1 is a company of 20 people. So then Mr. Dunn said, okay, I probably calculate the entry and the exit rate wrong if I give the one-man companies the same weight as the 10 or 20 man company. So therefore, he compared these two numbers. He didn't say you should exclude this. He said, what's the effect of neglecting this? That's a different thing. Yeah? So he didn't manipulate the data as some people might want to do, right? So he presents this and said, okay, that's the effect. You can decide yourself whether you want to have the one-man company in or not. So here you see the impact in the entry and the exit rate. My suggestion is that we drop the numbers of all firms and just look into smallest firms deleted, because this gives us more a better feeling of the impact in the industry. Here you also see the market share. In the market share, these small firms don't do a lot, right? All small firms together have only 0.03% impact. So therefore, it's probably reasonable to leave them out. So, okay, that's the first thing that we want to see. Then the second one, if you just look for these, then you see here for the time interval between 67 and 82, it's almost more or less constant entry rate. Please recall that this is for 5 years. The 40% that you see is for 5 years. So if you want to get the annual rate, then you divide by 5, right? So, okay, that's the first important thing. And here, by the way, it's only 3 years. So it means, 4 years, sorry. So this is 4 years, these are 5 years. Am I right? Yes, 5, 5, 5, and 4. So before we argue what happens in 1963, we better look into the time interval, right? And then compare it. So you see it's almost constant over time. That's an interesting thing. So the market share is also almost comparable of the new firms. The exit rate is also almost comparable, if you see it here. And if you compare these numbers with these numbers, then you see the US manufacturing industry has steadily grown, because in all these time intervals, you see the entry rate exceeds the exit rate. So you can guess the net rate is positive, and then you see the growth of this. So if you look a bit further into the impact of the small of the new firms coming to the market, then you can compare the market share and the relative size. So that is given here in this two numbers, market share and relative size. Let us just look into the exit rate of the relative size. So, here, of course, you see that the number of small firms generates some impact if you compare these relative size here and relative size there. Because you have so many small firms, one-man companies, for example, then of course the average relative size becomes very small, right? Because you have only few large firms and many small firms. So then you think, okay, the relative size of these firms is quite small. That's wrong. If you neglect all the one-man companies, for example, then you see that the relative size of the market share is quite considerable here. So what you can see here is that where's the market share here? It's about 13 or 18% of the market share that is occupied by the new firms. I forget about the one-man companies. So this is quite a remarkable number. I mean, you can divide it, of course, by the time interval, but still it's a large number, though. That means new firms have not the lion's share on the market, but they have a considerable number, right? So, and you can even see it here when they drop out. So of course they have increased their market share because they have grown in this time period maybe. So, but here, when you look into the relative size, you see you cannot ignore the part of the market that is occupied by firms dropping out or by new firms entering the market. This is what the number tells us. Okay? Yes, please.
How can relative size be?
The relative size is the total number of firms, the number of new firms entering the market, 100, divided by the total number of firms, 1,000, then we have 10%. Right? That's the relative size. It's a percentage of what accounts for the new firms. That's the idea. But of course, you can have a small firm, right? But a big market share. Therefore, the market share is not identical to the relative size, right? The market share measures your impact on the market, whereas the relative size just measures how much the firms occupy in numbers, right? That's the idea. Yeah. So, what do you want to say?
Maybe there is a bias in maybe we need a long data set to do.
So, you're arguing you want to see larger numbers here, or what do you want to say? Yeah, but what does it have to do with the crisis? You would assume there is a crisis and more firms drop out. Is this what you want to say? Okay, we come to this in a later slide, actually, right? So, There is an underlying business cycle, and you see clearly the correlations to the business cycle. There's even a slide that I show later on this. But the response is not that immediate, right? So you have to see what firms we are talking about. We are talking about the US manufacturing sector, right? So that is, if there is an oil crisis, so then you do not just lock the door and leave, right? So there is a period in which you respond to the oil crisis before you have to exit the market, right? So there's not a one-to-one correlation between these kind of events. But we look into this later on. Okay, let us have a 10-minute break here, and then we continue. Yeah? The lecture. As I said, we have some tables included here. So, and a good question for the exam is for example that you are presented some part of such a table, and then you should draw some conclusions of it, right? So just to give you a hint on the fact that you should learn to interpret these numbers yourself. And this is also the reason why we give you the literature, in case you have questions and you can look up what is the correct, not the correct, what was the intention or the interpretation given by the authors of that study. Okay. Now, oh, good. Let me go now to a bit more of theory. I already mentioned Mr. Schumpeter's theory, which is behind the dynamics of entry and exit rate. I think I only have like three or four pictures of persons here in this lecture, and these are always very famous ones. Mr. Schumpeter was a real famous and important economist. He did a lot of work in economics, which we do not want to discuss here. He also thought about the future of democratic societies. Will this be maintained? What's the future of capitalism? So he had a very broad intention. What we are interested here are these contributions to the theory of firms and to entrepreneurship. So he developed two theories, which are dubbed as Mark I and Mark II. Mark I was developed while he was in Europe, and Mark II was developed while he was in the US. And both of them point into opposite directions. That's the interesting thing. In Europe, in this theory called Mark I, Schumpeter put forward the argument that innovation is driven by new companies entering the market. He referred a lot to this entrepreneurial spirit, or in German, Unternehmergeist, yeah, which is important to get some dynamics in the economy. Right? So the new firms enter the market, it challenges the established firms. So there's a competition like David and Goliath. Yeah? So, and then David wins and Goliath have to leave. Right? That's the underlying idea. Then he went to the US, he became a professor there, and he completely changed his mind. He said, okay, no new firms may have good ideas, but they do not have the resources to develop these good ideas. The resources have the big company, right? It's great that you have this idea about audio compression, right? But only a company like Sony is able to make something out of this in order to affect the market and to change the product landscape. So this was the second idea. So he said, okay, capital is important, equipment is important, and therefore the big companies with their big research and development divisions are the most responsible ones. Today we do not look at this as either or, but as well as. Right? So both of these theories hold, dependent on what sector of the market you look at and what data you have available. So So here is a bit more detail on his hypothesis of creative destruction. So that's a nice buzzword, independent of this particular notion. So you destroy something in order to develop room for something new, right? So there's always something good if a whole industry crashes or is teared down. So that's the idea. So and here in particular, as I said, so he assumes that the new firms are the sources of innovation. And the old firms cannot cope with this pace of development because they are less efficient. They are too large to adapt to something new before they get the point, so they are already behind everything. No? That was the idea. Of course, I mean, this has a lot of impact also in the industry if, for example, some technology changes. That was also his argument. The example that he took was, so there was a whole industry of horse carriages, and then the automobile was invented, and then the whole industry of horse carriages was completely, became completely obsolete, and so the whole market was taken over by automobiles, right? And this was then, this turmoil was then dubbed with the term market turbulence. And market turbulence has two meanings here, though. Market turbulence can be related to the entry and exit dynamics of the firms, but it is also related to the fact in which firms change their market share, right? If we think of the mobile communication market, right? Then there is a market turbulence, which can be seen by the fact that a firm like Nokia, who has ruled a large part of the market, now is heavily decreasing in market share, right? So that's also a market turbulence. You cannot trace this down to a new company entering the market, but you can certainly trace it down to a big company supporting a small company, right? Like Google with the Android phones and so on. Right? So there's a clear relation. So it's not always that you can identify the small company that now had a cascade established to turn over the market. Here we have another view on entry and exit dynamics. It shows us the entry and exit rates for different countries in Europe in the time 1990 to 2000. So, and here you can look into established economies, which are characterized by lower, not low, but lower entry rates, but also lower exit rates. So that's an established, mature economy, like Western Germany, but also Italy or Denmark or whatever, right? So, and there are, on the other end, countries that made a major transition in their political regime, from a socialist country into a country of free market capitalism. We are not arguing whether this transition was good or bad, that's not the point. So what we are arguing is that this political transition is reflected in a huge number of new firms established, simply because before the economic conditions and also the legal conditions to run your own company were much worse. That is what the story behind is. And then now, because you have lowered the legal entry barrier, so everyone could found a company if people had the power to do so, or the effort, wanted to spend the effort on this, so you can reflect. At the same time, you see that for the established companies, the exit rate is almost equal to the entry rate. That means there's not a huge net rate growth in the economy. Here it's very different. What can we conclude from this? The market was empty, right? So that's the only conclusion we can do. Yeah? So therefore, very many companies could enter the market and very few had to leave. This picture, of course, changes when you really come to the period of strong competition. And then, of course, the free market capitalism, which we, by the way, will also model then, so puts a lot of effort on all these established companies. Right? So, and then you will see that, of course, in the long term, the exit rate increases and then balances the entry rate if these companies come to a saturated growth. So now let us put this into stylized fact. What is the hard fact or the stylized fact that we can really deduce from these entry and exit numbers? It's a very weak statement that we can make only. There is a positive correlation between entry rate and exit. It's not too much what we claim here, right? So if very many firms enter the market, then very many firms exit the market. That's the only thing we say. This keeps the economic growth bounded, right? Can you imagine what it would mean if there was an anti-correlation? If very many firms exit the market, very few firms leave the market, then you basically means that the economy is exploding, right? You would not have enough workforce, you would not have enough capital, and so on, right? So, okay. So this is has a number of implications that we have also marked here on the slide. We have already seen that the survival rate of the new firms entering the market is quite low. Remember, this 50% in Switzerland after 5 years. So that is a low survival rate of new firms entering the market. So therefore, you have this positive correlation because most of them do not make it. Right? So that's the implication of this. So there are further correlations towards the business cycle, of course. There is also a correlation towards the product life cycle. Do you still remember what the product life cycle was? Maybe from the course Systems Dynamics and Complexity? So you don't remember it. So can you explain to us what the product life cycle was? Yeah, more or less like this. So there is a life cycle. If you have the iPhone, yeah, something, a new product, so then in the beginning you have a strong growth because everyone wants to buy this product. So then you get a saturation, and then instead of the iPhone, then the beta phone is invented, right? And the iPhone dies, and the beta phone is taking over. That's the idea. And of course, if you are in the early phase of the iPhone, and then you are the company who writes all the nice apps for this, right? So then you grow, of course. But if you enter the market with your iPhone and with your Apple app business at a time when no one cares about the iPhone, then of course you're going down. This is the meaning. Oh, here, okay. So what we see here, the last sentence is, because of this correlation, Schumpeter's creative destruction is not validated by empirical evidence. Why is this not the case? How do we see this? Who wants to comment on this? So the constructive, the creative destruction hypothesis included the idea all the new firms come up with this bright new products and business ideas, and they challenge the established firms, and the established firms kick out of the market. So why don't we see this here? What's the reason for this? Yeah, please.
Schumpeter was saying that new firms should survive, but
right, exactly. Yeah, this is the underlying assumption. The new firm is better than the old one, so the new firm should survive and the old one should disappear. That's not the case. We do not see this. We see new firms enter the market, but only very few of them survive. That is exactly the reason. So that means if you have to argue in the exam, why don't we see Schumpeter's hypothesis at work, then that's the argument. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
In exit rate, there are old and new firms. Yeah, can
that's
you,
true.
Put a point like most of the exiting firms are new firms.
We can put this. This is not explicitly said here. We can put this argument because there is empirical evidence for this. But the Stylites fact, as such, does not have this. Why is this the case? Let's think of this example of the horse carriers that are overtaken by automobiles, right? So then you have the established firm, right? And the established firm also leaves the market. Why is this? Because a complete new technology takes over, right? So that is the reason. I mean, you are right with your statement. Most, the exit rate is the highest for the new firms. That's correct, but it depends on what scenario you are looking at. Therefore, this Stylites fact is formulated a bit weaker than what you said, but your comment is, of course, correct. So here we have a table that shows us different countries and compares the entry rate both as in terms of the number of firms. So these are all percentages, right? So. But in one case, we refer to the firm number, and in the other case, we refer to the market share, right? So you can, we can go through this now. Well, Belgium, they made a distinction between manufacturing firms and services. This is also very important to have this, distinction, because, as we discussed during the break, manufacturing firms, for example, depend on issues like the oil price, the availability of natural resources, these kind of things. Yeah? The immigration laws of Switzerland or Canada, all these kind of things. Yeah? Whereas a service company has other boundary conditions. Yeah? You can still run a business and then use the internet to let the people in India program your stuff, right? So they do not need to be physically there in Canada, right? So that means you will not see the same dynamics for the manufacturing firms and for the service firms. That's important to understand. You will see dependencies on the business cycle, but usually not. On the other hand, what we also discussed before when we talked about insurance business versus construction business, of course, service companies have a lower entry barrier because they do not need to put up a lot of physical things. So whereas manufacturing firms usually have a higher entry barrier. So therefore the pattern becomes much more complicated. So this is what you see here, right? So there's a high number of firms or relative number, that's percentage, as I said, compared to manufacturing. You know why this is the reason. Because the barriers are differently. So if you look into the exit rates, then you see that this matches nicely here, right? So you have a high exit rate. Yeah? It's a positive correlation, high entry rate, high exit rate. That was the only claim that we made in the Stylites fact. Oh, by the way, so now I recognize that why I wanted to do it differently. So I wanted to do it like this. And then we can use the cursor. And then, yes, this is what I wanted to do, actually. I rarely use this because we usually do not have tables, and then I forget about this. So this is something that we can look up here in the number of firms, yeah? Entry and exit rate, how this is correlated. So here we see, of course, that the evidence is across 8 different countries. These are all very mature economies. Yeah? So Korea means South Korea. So these are all established economies. The time interval is differently. That means if you see something like this here, where the exit rate in manufacturing is larger than the entry rate, that's what you see there, right? It has well to do with the business cycle. It has well to do with the conditions in Belgium between 1980 and 84, right? You see, the data is from various intervals here, and it's not always some are covering the like the first part of the business cycle, others the second part. Therefore, you cannot really compare all these numbers. Yeah? So you should note this. You should see the correlations here. You should also see, if you look into the market share, the impact of new firms entering the market. So you see it's always between, yeah, it's about 3%. That was the same number that we have seen before when we looked into the Dunn paper. Yeah? Fluctuates a bit. Here it's much smaller. So then if you want to argue why it is 1.1% in Norway, whereas Germany, 3% in Germany, or 5% or 6% in Portugal, then you have to look into how the economy is structured, right? So you have to think, okay, what is the major business in Norway, right? So, and then I come up with my small insurance company, right? What might be the impact on the market share compared to Statoil, for example, right? So that's not a lot. So this is then, if you argue like this, then you understand why some of the numbers are high and some of the numbers are low. Okay, last table. Here, this again from Mr. Dunn. He looked into correlations of entry and exit rate. Remember that the Starlight factor is about correlations between entry and exit rate. So he has given the exit rate of different time intervals. That was this US manufacturing industry's data set, right? That we talked about. So these are the exit rates given. So this is similar, but let us just look into this. And now he looks into how it's the exit rate of this time interval correlated to the entry rate of another time interval. So here in the first part, he just calculates the correlations. So what he sees is there's always a positive correlation between the exit rate and the entry rate. That was the meaning of the Starlight's fact, right? Okay. Then the first confusing thing appears if you look here, for example. So how can the exit rate in 1977 be correlated to the entry rate of in 1963? Of course, I mean, if the company stayed for like 15 years there, there is a correlation. But if you do it the other way around, how can the entry rate, what was the other example I looked into? The exit rate, the correlation between the exit rate in 1963 and the entry rate in 1977. Okay, so this, in order to understand these numbers, you have to think of what is the meaning of a correlation, right? A correlation is not a causality, right? So it simply tells, okay, if there was a period in time, like 15 years ago, where the exit rate was high, then, of course, the market was somehow turned over. And this allows later for new firms entering the market. That is why we see a positive correlation, right? So, but there is not a one-to-one causality. Because of this, that happens. Or the other way around. You know? So Because then you ask yourself, why is it, you cannot really understand this causality, that something that happens earlier affects something that happens later is clear, but that something that happens later affects something that happens earlier, so we do not believe this. But it refers to the conditions that are created under which these entry and exit rates can change. Okay, so you see that's Stahler's fact number one. But now Mr. Dunn did something differently. He did a correction for fixed industry effects. Does anyone have an idea what a fixed industry effect is? Oh, for example, the oil price, you know, the legal conditions, these kind of things, yeah? Environmental laws, all these kind of things. So, and then you see that these positive correlations turn mainly into negative correlations. So. And then you see that the whole thing is much more determined by subtle developments in the industry as a whole. Later, I think in two lectures or so, we have a model where we look into different correlations, where the growth rate of a firm depends on the growth rate of the industry, but also on the growth rate of the economy as a whole. So there is a correlation. Yeah? If you are in a booming country like Lithuania, then of course there is an effect of the overall growth rate of the industry on the entry and exit rate of your specific business, which is maybe in construction or I don't know. Yeah? So. And here you see these correlations turn into negative correlations. That means there is a high entry rate but a low exit rate, or the other way around. There is a low entry rate but a high exit rate. And this refers to conditions inside the industry. You understand what I mean? No? So that means one of the driving factors here is indeed the boundary conditions or the overall conditions of the industry and of the economy as a whole. That is what you see here. That is why these correlations turn into negative one if we control for the fixed industry effects. So now we move to the papers not written by the economists but by the physicists. So now everything changes, no tables anymore, no numbers, just these plots. So you can guess from these figures who did it. You can also see from the arguments who did it, right? So of course, Mr. Dunn was very careful in controlling, for example, for the fixed industry effects, right? So these people don't care, right? So. Okay. What we see here is the data set we already discussed, where we have seen the nice log normal distribution, as you recall. And here is the total number of companies plotted over time. So you see these are, I think they were 20 years, yes. And then you see how the total number of companies in the US manufacturing sector oscillates. Do you see this? That's the total number of companies. And of course you see a business cycle here, right? You can clearly determine the business cycle. If you look into this, then you see that how the new and the new entrance and the firms dying contribute to this. You clearly see that, of course, there is an anti-correlation. If this total number goes down, then the number of dying companies is quite large. But you see that the number of new firms entering the market is not synchronous in time. You see this? Yeah? So, coming back to our Stahler's fact, there's a positive correlation between entry and exit. Well, we can say, well, that might be true, but not for any instance in time. That's a different thing, right? And the Stahler fact didn't claim this, right? But if I look into a particular year, then I see, of course, that there might be a high exit rate and a low entry rate, or the other way around. But if I average this over time, then I see a very clear correlation between the two. That's important. Yeah? So if I go for time series analysis, then I see this kind of anti-correlation that, by the way, was also shown in the table of Mr. Dunn, right? Because there are a few more effects that we have to take into account. If we just take the gross picture, then we see the positive correlation. But if we control for certain things, like the business cycle, then we see a different picture. You get this point, right? So, okay. Here, they looked into the firm size distribution. So, this is it for all companies. This is for the dying companies. And this is for the new companies. So. Again, the size is measured in this example in terms of in sales. That's the sales number. What they claim here, it's a bit difficult to see, is that for the new firms, that is the lowest one, here this one, they claim that there is a log normal distribution. We should believe them. Yeah, I hope someone has checked this. We can check it here by looking into this parabola-like shape. Looks a bit like this. So, but for these two distributions, there is a slight difference. So they did not confirm that's a log normal distribution, but an exponential distribution of third order polynomial. We are not going into the details here. What I just want to say is that if you look into specific parts like the dying companies, you may find a different distribution. But if you aggregate over the whole industry, then you see this clear log normal pattern. So I'll come to this in a moment with another example as well. The surprising thing is here. Right? What does this mean? I mean, this is size, so sales, this means 10 to the 10 US dollars, right? So you have a new company entering the market, right? We are always thinking of the one-man company, but this is a huge company, right? This is one of the largest companies that you can think of, yeah, in this data set. What's the meaning of that, right? And then we see that a large company, a very large company, is dying, right? Okay, how do you comment on this? Now, let's assume we have the exam and you should explain why there are big companies entering and leaving the market. What's the reason for this? And how does this refer to Starlight's fact number four, where we talked about age and size? Yeah. Absolutely. Correct. So.
While a dying company that gets like a lot of sales per month, maybe it's Lehman Brothers.
Maybe it's Lehman Brothers, but maybe it's a part of the newly formed company, right?
Right.
This is the reason why we see this. The data set doesn't tell us whether the company really died. Now, maybe the company has died in a legal sense, but it's now part of, I don't know, a large pharmaceutical company or something like this, right? That's the idea, right? So mainly, these things can be explained through merger and acquisitions. I think I mentioned this here as well, right? Change of name is another thing that you cannot detect in the data set. Yeah? If you, for legal reason, change your name, so then a big company dies and a big new company is born. Right? That's what the data tells us. But then, of course, I mean, you can track down these cases. You say, okay, what company are we talking about? And then you look it up and then you say, well, there is a reason for this. This is not what these people were interested in. But if you're an economist or you do your PhD in management science, then you certainly go more into detail. So these people were already happy after they found the log normal distribution for the firms. Right? So that's also nice, but okay, there is more in this. Okay. So this tells us the dying probability dependent on the size. It is not a surprise that firms with a smaller size have a larger dying probability. We already talked about this. Firms of a smaller size have a larger volatility in their growth. That's what you already remember from Stylites fact number two. Firms of a smaller size are usually firms that are also younger. There is a correlation between the age and the growth rate, which is also negative, right? So that means if you are a small firm and a young firm, you may not make it, right? So it means you have a high probability to die. Remember the 50% in 5 years for Switzerland. So if you reach a mature size, then this probability remains almost constant. That's the message here. Right? So it is not zero because there are these instances that big firms collapse because they have bet on the wrong horses, in the financial business, for example. But they can also die because there is merger and acquisition. So it's a bit difficult to see that this is constant. No? Some people would argue for something like this. I'm not going to comment on this. So if you are not the physicist but the economist, what would you do in front of such a picture? No, you would probably go for economic or management arguments that it is either like this and either like that. So that means you, as a person who gets this degree in MTech, you would probably formulate a hypothesis that is built on economic theories and economic insights or insights from the management side, right? You would not simply go and plot the data and then say, well, we think it's linear, right? Or we think it's constant, right? You wouldn't do that, right? You see, this is a major difference between doing science in economics and management science and doing econophysics, right? I mean, I'm a physicist myself, I can say this. In econophysics, the people have all these nice insights like this one, but they have no clue about the meaning. That's the problem here, right? So, and at some point you appreciate that you do not just plot things and sell it to the audience, but that you also have a story to tell. So, and that's a major difference. And that's why I'm in this department and not in the physics department. I'm also a professor in the physics department, but that's a complete different mind setting, right? So, all right. So here we have a few other evidence numbers here. I'm not going to read this here. So let us look into this example because I think it's important to understand this before we close. So we already heard about the log normal distribution of all firms, right? Then we heard about the log normal distribution. Let me go back to this slide here. The log normal distribution of new firms entering the market. We didn't hear about the log normal distribution of firms leaving the market. These are the dying firms here. We didn't hear about that. Instead, we heard about a third order polynomial. So no one knows precisely what the difference is, but probably there is a difference. Okay. That's another issue, So, okay, but here you see the people claim that the dying firms also follow a log normal distribution in size. That is a claim here, right? So that's not the same as Luis Amaral and co-workers claimed. Yeah, it's not the same, but so that's it's in line with other arguments that we had. There's a skewed distribution for all firms, so maybe there should be also a skewed distribution for dying firms and for newborn firms. So that's what you see in the data. But in fact, as these people argue here, this is aggregated data. So they look at it over, I don't know, time interval of 20 years. Yeah, we can go back to the Amaral paper, and then we see, okay, they have averaged over 20 years. Right? And when they average over 20 years, then they may see a log normal distribution. The question is, how did we get the log normal distribution? So, in fact, firms are born and die every single day in the year, right? So, and the question is, does this picture that emerges over 20 year, over a 20 year interval, does it also hold if we go for day-to-day events? That was the question that was asked here. And these people argue that the day-to-day underlying distribution is a different one. If you aggregate all these distributions here, then you may end up in a log normal distribution. But if I talk about the monthly events, for example, or the weekly events, then it's not very clear that we get a log normal distribution, also for these time intervals. So their argument is actually out of the blue, I have to say, but yeah, that's my personal comment. So it's this one. So they assume that if we disaggregate the data, it can be described by this kind of distribution. So what is it? What kind of distribution is it? So it's a power law, I to the minus R, right? R is the exponent, and I is our usual x value. So, and that's a normalization here. And the normalization applies up to a value m, which defines some sort of size class, right? So. Okay. And now they are trying to test this for the disaggregated data against some simulation value. So they have the assumption that there is, you see, that's an indirect proof. Yeah? They have the assumption that the data follows this distribution. So why is it a truncated power law? Because the m gives us a value at which we truncate this, right? So. So, and now they do the following. They say, let's assume that this is the distribution the data follows. So then we do the following. We generate artificial data from this distribution. We take the disaggregated data from this data set. We plot this against each other. And that's what they do here. That's what's also called a QQ plot, or this kind of thing. So that means if the aggregate, if the simulated data, which is here on the x-axis, matches the real data about dying firms, then we should see a straight line, a diagonal, exactly at 45 degrees. Yes, please.
Is it 45 degrees? It's not from the lower end to the
There are many comments on this. So if these were my graduate students, right? Let's assume that. Then I would tell them, okay, if you want to show that, then you have to use the square, right? That's the first thing. Yeah? So they have plotted this in a rectangle, and they have even used different scales for the axis, okay? So that means they made it very difficult for us to recognize that there is a 45 degree line, right? So now you can argue, did they do this on purpose, or did they do this because they do not recognize, okay. I'm not going to comment on this. I just met one of the co-authors yesterday here in ITER. Okay. Yeah, so that's the idea. You would probably, if you really want to show this, you take a square, right? You make sure that the two axes are precisely the same, and then you really mark the straight line. Is this your comment?
If the distributions are not the same, then it won't be 45-degree line, right?
No, then you would, no, you would see a correlation, but it would not be the same, yes. Distribution. Yes, in a Q plot, it should be on this 45-degree line. Yes, please.
But isn't it more precise to say that if we see a straight line, we can say that the distributions are the same, but they are not scaled?
Yes, that's also correct. Yeah. That's also correct. There can be a difference. There can be also a difference in the normalization, of course, right? So, but let me finish with this. So that means the argument, and that's an important argument, is the following. The aggregated data over 20 years may show us a log normal distribution. But we do not know how this log normal distribution is accumulated. So therefore, their proposal here is, so they didn't defend, they didn't explain this well, why they had this. So they say, okay, the daily data, the disaggregated data, follows a very different distribution, namely a truncated power law. Right? And then they took the disaggregated data, simulated data from a truncated power law, and showed us in this straight line that there is a match. The match doesn't hold for all data, as you see, not for the large size, not for the small size. It holds only for the middle. Right? So you can have lots of arguments against this if you want to. The reason why I'm showing you this is another one. It is known, and this is all the how the people started here, that this describes the exit rate of biological species. So there is outside, if you have a look at these posters, it's about ecology, how species survive and die, right? So that is what the people on the poster outside tell you. So, and we know already from dying species that the number of species dying follows this kind of distribution, and we know that the R is 2, right? And then the people said, okay, if species die like this truncated power law with R over 2, let's look if firms also die according to this truncated power law with R equals 2. So, and the result is, yes, they do. That's the result here, yeah? Also confirmed for 8 different OECD countries and so on. So that is a nice message. If you think of firms dying, so then, I mean, the birth of the firm is like, of course, the birth in a biological setting. Yeah? It's a small firm in the beginning, it grows over time, likely to an optimal size, and then it dies. So there are all these biological arguments. And this is another argument that confirms that this kind of life cycle of a firm really holds. Yeah? That's the message from this. Yeah? Well, if you look into the disaggregated data, you see that firms die over time according to this distribution. Okay. I already made it without finishing. Yes, it's not. Okay. Let me just come to one last remark, because next week I'm not here and Pavlin is going to teach, and I don't want to leave this for Pavlin. No? So. The last Stylites fact we are talking about is survival of firms. So we implicitly discussed this already, so we now take a variable I. This is 1 if the firm has survived, and 0 if the firm has died. So we already know that age plays a role and size plays a role. Well, we do not know what's the precise function of age and size is. So we name it D. D depends on these two variables, right? So, and then we draw a random number from a distribution and we say, okay, if the random number is larger than the D, then the firm survives, and if it's smaller, then the firm dies. So that means that D defines a threshold at which the firm dies, right? The threshold is very, if the threshold is very high, then it's likely that the firm dies. If the threshold is very low, it's likely that it survives. This is simply a definition. So, And now we are looking into the expectation value. And that's the probability that this random number E is larger than this threshold that we have just defined without knowing what the dependence is, right? So, and this probability is simply the cumulative distribution function of the D here, right? You see this? We are asking what's the probability that some value E is larger than D. So, and this is the definition of a cumulative distribution function, namely F of D. We have no clue how this distribution function looks like, right? So we have also no clue. We don't know how the D looks like. We also don't know how the F looks like. But we are not really interested in this. We just say if we could know this cumulative distribution function, then the standard facts number six says that the cumulative distribution function should increase with X. So that means your survival will be larger if you have a larger size. Yeah? Or the other way around, if you have a small size, then you might likely die. Or the other way around, you have a small size because you were just born. You have also a small age, and then you also die, right? So that's the idea behind it. You understand the argument. We did not define how the threshold looked like. We just said it depends on age, which the age and the size. And we did not define the cumulative distribution function. But this argument tells us we are not interested in this. We just look into the tail of this. So, and we say that this is positive. So, and in the same way, we argue that the survival rate increases with age without specifying the F. That's important. So you see our statement about survival dependent on age and size is weak. Weak in the sense that we did not specify any concrete distribution or how the threshold is defined. But the assumption is if we define a threshold, we are able to empirically determine the cumulative distribution function, and we will probably see this kind of dependence. Okay? So, if we combine this, then we see that the growth patterns of the smaller and the larger firms differ. Why that? Because if you have a smaller firm then and a younger firm, then the probability that you also die is larger. So, you can read this at home. I think this slide is not so important. So, that's your self-study talks, and these are the questions. So, by now, I would expect that you know all these six, seven Starlight's facts, that you can name them, that you can argue why these Starlight's facts exist. What is the real meaning of this? Why can't we be more specific about certain things? That's also important. Some of the Starlight's facts are not very precise. Some are very precise. What's the reason that some of them are not precise? Like the correlation of entry and exit rate. We discussed it, that we see this in the data, but only if we do not look into the reasons for this. If we, for example, subtract the fixed industry effects, which we did in this example, then we see that this correlation is broken, right? So that's a very important thing. So that means it's not there for all times and under all conditions. There are reasons for this that are somehow hidden in this positive correlation. And they may refer to the industry, for example, or to the business cycle. That's only on average. So this kind of argumentation you should be really able to do. With this, I stop. Next week, as I said, Pavlin will give this lecture, but only if there are at least five people. Yeah? That's our threshold from now on. You keep it in mind, you talk to the other people. Thank you very much for your attention, and I see you in 2 weeks.